In 1986, Nashville-born Russell Freeman founded a jazz ensemble called the Rippingtons. The band practically invented what came to be called smooth jazz.
Well, I grew up in Nashville. My dad was a pretty accomplished guitarist and pianist, and he had a lot of influences he turned us on to. I listened to a lot of James Taylor, a lot of the Beatles. He loved classical music, and so I had this wide influences, and I started playing classical guitar about age 10. And luckily enough, he was friends with a lot of studio players in Nashville, so they turned me on to a lot of country music as well, so it was pretty diverse. In 1978, I attended CalArts. I had a full scholarship, and I couldn't wait to get out of Nashville to get to L.A. because all my musical heroes were in L.A. at the time. So I went to CalArts for a couple of years, and then I went to UCLA.
In 1985, Russ recorded his first album, technically a solo effort, Nocturnal Playground. He asked some L.A. musician friends to sit in, and thus the musical roots of the Rippingtons were forming.
We started playing at a small club in North Hollywood called the Baked Potato on Monday nights and quickly started packing the place. And it became a hangout for all the local musicians who would come down and sit in with the band. And that's actually the place where I met guys like Kenny G and David Benoit, who started sitting in. And that was really the jumping off point for the Rippingtons, that club. One night we were in a small club called Josefina's on Ventura Boulevard. And I was seeing some of my friends on stage playing, and they were doing great. And I said, those guys are ripping. They're the Rippingtons. And I just, in my mind, I thought, we can use that. We can use that name. So it stuck. And when I was 9 years old, I'll never forget the Beatles breaking up. And I was heartbroken as a kid because I would always go to the record store and couldn't wait for their latest album. And I vowed at the early age of 9, I said, if I ever start my own band, it's never going to break up. And I always kept that in mind. So when I started the Rippingtons, I knew it was unrealistic to expect the same personnel. So my basic philosophy with the Rips is that it would be a revolving personnel. It would be changing, and that would help it to last over time. The very first lineup for the Rippingtons was David Benoit on piano and Greg Kourakos on keyboards. We had two keyboard players. We had Bill Lanfear on bass, Tony Morales on drums, Steve Reed on percussion, and I believe it was Kenny G was the first saxophone player, and then Brandon Fields.
In 1986, the new band's first album, Moonlighting, quickly established an ensemble with a unique sound, later dubbed smooth jazz. One song in particular, She Likes to Watch, became a hit.
On Moonlighting, our first CD, I remember the thing I was most trying to accomplish was to get my production chops better. I knew I was going to hire all my friends to come in and play, and I just wanted to write the best songs I could and produce them as best I could. I have no idea why She Likes to Watch is so popular with our fans. It's always been a popular song, and it's instantly recognizable, and it's something that they always want to hear. With Kilimanjaro, we really started touring much more than we had before. Before that record, it was kind of a studio band. We would just come in and play, and then the guys would build their own careers. When we started touring, it became apparent to me we needed a kind of a more solid personnel, and that's when guys like Mark Portman joined the band and Steve Bailey. I remember making friends with Dave Cause, and he seemed so young at the time. He's only a couple of years younger than me, but he seemed like such a kid. And he came in to play Iwi, actually, on Kilimanjaro. And what a fantastic musician. Even from the very beginning, I loved his playing. He was a super nice guy.
I was on the very first Rippingtons project that came out. Actually, this kind of an interesting story is I didn't play saxophone. on that first project. I played the electronic wind instrument. And the story at the time was this, that Russ was signed to another deal as a solo artist. And so he had this special sound that he got out of his guitar that was kind of like a guitar, but kind of like a synthesizer too. And he wanted to recreate that sound on the Rippingtons album, but he couldn't because he was contractually obligated to this other company. So he said, well, we'll get you to play your electronic wind instrument that sounds similar to it. And that's how I got involved in that first project. However, since then, I haven't played that instrument really, and I've come to be known as a saxophone player.
As the band developed its reputation for sparkling live performances, the question of how to describe their music was already being widely discussed, such as in this tongue-in-cheek report from Canadian television.
All right, we'd like you to be the judge. This is music by the Rippingtons. It's been called popular music, jazz, jazz fusion, new age, and even just plain contemporary. Well, what do you think?
Some people call this new age music, and it's a handy place to put stuff in the record store. Other people call it fusion jazz. Jazz lovers would never allow this to be called jazz.
Yeah, but I don't even like the word jazz anymore. I mean, I used to, but...
I do, I love it.
The Canadian government has radio station cops called the CRTC, and they can't decide whether the Rippingtons fit into music category 5 or music category 6. You see, the stations are given quotas in each category. 5 is pop music, and 6 is sort of other. And so, until there's an official government definition of New Age music, you could get the Rippingtons on this radio station, Category 6, or this one, Category 5, pop, or this one.
Tourist in Paradise saw the band touring even more extensively, including the Rippingtons' first glimpse of Japan.
Tourist in Paradise was the album that I feel I was trying to combine the live energy of our live show with the prowess and the studio chops we had accumulated in the previous two albums. So I was trying to put it all together and create the energy we had on stage and put it in the studio. Japan was a trip because we went all the way over to this new country. I'll never forget first flying into Narita, thinking this is like a different continent. And a week later I was walking down the streets of Tokyo, and from a cafe I heard one of my songs blasting. It's like they already knew who we were in Tokyo. It was a tremendous feeling.
As the decade began, the Rippingtons were on a roll, starting with a new album, Welcome to the St. James Club.
I'll never forget when we found out Welcome to the St. James Club had debuted at number one. We were in New York City in a tiny club called The Bottom Line. It was such an exciting feeling to think that our album debuted at number one.
As the band's main composer and producer, Russ Freeman's move from L.A. to Colorado had a huge impact on the Rippingtons.
Here's a song called Aspen for you.
Aspen is the first song I wrote for Curves Ahead, and it kind of set the pace for the whole album, and definitely my favorite song on that record. I'd say that Colorado really was the inspiration for the entire album of Curves Ahead. I was really excited to move to Colorado and away from the rat race of L.A. I remember as a studio player in L.A., I was so excited to finally be able to make records, and I would look inside and the producer would be on the phone talking about his next record. And I thought, I want to get away from that environment and have a place where, you know, we can focus on our record making. I ended up buying the entire Warner Brothers studio from Amigo in L.A. And it was great because it had all the Warner Brothers logos on it. And my idea was to have an environment where we could come and focus on record making without being distracted. And it was a wonderful studio, beautiful place.
In August 1992, the Rippingtons released Weekend in Monaco. Among the tour stops was the Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland.
Welcome to Russell Freeman and the Rippingtons!
To support our Weekend in Monaco album, we toured Europe and we played the Montreux Jazz Festival. That was the first time we played with big acts like Eric Clapton and Ringo Starr and Joe Walsh, and there was many of them. I think Todd Rundgren was there as well. And one of my favorite moments from that was I got a chance to interview Joe Walsh. And the first thing I'd always wanted to know, I asked him, I said, Joe, is it true that the Eagles crew put the furniture upside down and tacked it to the ceiling of the Beverly Hills Hotel? And he actually said it was in fact true. They did that. Live in LA was our first live album, and it was the first time we had done a full concert length video. And what was great about it and unique about it is it was one of the very first high definition videos ever shot. It was a great experience for us. It became a hugely popular video, and the next night we did the live album version in LA at the Greek Theater. In 1994, we had an opportunity to found Peak Records, and the idea was we wanted to control our own musical destiny and to create an environment where we could help other artists as well and nurture new talent. So we took the advantage of that business opportunity and created a really nice label.
Through the 90s, the Rippingtons continued a prodigious output, releasing 4 albums in 5 years, Sahara, Brave New World, Black Diamond, and Topaz. Walking the road,
love's last step for soul. For Sahara, we did a very extended Southeast Asian tour, and it was the first time I had a chance to experience places like Jakarta, Singapore, Manila. It was wonderful.
And now it's up to me to bow out gracefully.
Black Diamond signifies our 10-year anniversary. There's a double entendre for a ski slope. Black Diamond is typically what's known as an expert slope, or just experts only. Black Diamond was the first album we recorded on the Peak label, and it was also a number one album, very popular record.
Black Diamond debuted at number one on Billboard's Contemporary Jazz chart, pushing former Rippington Kenny G out of the top spot.
By the late 90s, I think it was becoming apparent to a lot of musicians that to be in the Rips was a great launching pad for their own careers. And it actually turned out to be true with guys like Jeff Koshua, who went on to his own success after he had been with us for several years. So we had more personnel changes happen in the late 90s. We were really sorry to see Tony Morales leave the band. He was a wonderful friend and a great musician. And he just decided instead of being a musician, he wanted to be a computer programmer.
By the end of the decade, the Rippingtons were weaving Caribbean, Native American, and other indigenous music into their work, and were regarded among the premier ensembles in recorded music.
I think if you don't mix different musical genres and mix things up a bit, it can get boring. So I think it's important to listen to new elements of music and to try new things and to take chances. We were honored to receive the Oasis Awards that we received. Best band for a couple of years. I know we had a best video award. I got a best producer in there somewhere. But the nice thing about it was that this was an award from your own peers. And it was a short-lived kind of a award ceremony. I think they only did it for several years, but it was still nice.
The end of the century coincided with another turning point for the band. Russ Freeman moved his bass from snowy Colorado to sunny South Florida. The impact on the music was immediately evident on the next release, Life in the Tropics, the Rippingtons' first CD to be digitally recorded.
I think all your writing is autobiographical in a way. And in my own life, I remember shoveling some snow in May, thinking, man, it's got to be warm in L.A., and thinking, I love it when we tour places like Miami. And suddenly I think the idea was born that maybe I would move on and move to Miami, and it came to happen a couple of years later. And it's been a really tremendous change, you know, lifestyle change as well as musically.
The band's next album was recorded live on tour. It featured yet another revised Rippingtons lineup.
I never really worried that the fans would react adversely to new personnel, because I always feel a musician brings his own expertise to the band. And it's part of the makeup of what, you know, what makes the band unique. We've had such tremendous talent come through the band. And in early 2000, guys like Eric Marienthal, one of my favorite musicians in the world, came. And of course, one of my great buddies, Bill Heller, in the band. So I think from probably 2000 on, it's been the tightest band we've ever had. I was very happy with Live Across America because I think it really captured the essence of what we were doing at the time. We were playing all sorts of places. And I wanted to get a cross-section of maybe the same song recorded in four or five different cities. Sometimes when you record a live album, you don't have that much time, you know? What we recorded, about 20 or 30 concerts.
Everything the Rippingtons does is fun. You know, especially for me, you know, Russ, I think, in a former life was a saxophone player, because everything he writes is just, you know, it fits perfectly with the way, you know, a sax player plays and thinks, and so there's never been a tune ever where it just, you know, oh, you know, this seems like it should have been written for guitar.
Let It Rip was really different than a lot of our previous albums, and it's been different than almost all the records in the sense that it's the live band playing in the studio more than any other. It's really, there's not much studio hocus pocus going on. It's the live guys playing the real songs.
In 2005, Latin musical influences were all over Wild Card. That was no accident.
Wild Card had some wonderful guest artists. Willie Chirino, a fabulous salsa singer. Albita, one of the premier Cuban salsa singers. And Chante Moore. And we were lucky to get all three. And the reason we got them was the co-writer that I was writing with, Yadet Leon, had a relationship with Albita and Willie Chirino, and we were very blessed that they decided to come and appear on our CD.
In After 20 years, Russ Freeman is understandably proud not just of the music, but of the people who are part of the Rippingtons' heritage, especially his relationship with the group's manager, Andy Howard.
I realized when we started the band it would be impossible to keep the same personnel. So I built it kind of into the idea of the band that it would be changing over time. And I think the reason that's been so successful is I didn't realize, first of all, we'd be around 20 years later, but the fact that new blood comes in, the music itself evolves. And that's really what it takes, I think, to be successful over a long period of time.
With all the personnel changes, one key band member has never left the Rippingtons.
The Jazz Cat, which is our logo, was drawn by a fantastic artist named Bill Mayer, who lives in Atlanta. He drew the 1984 Atlanta Jazz Festival poster, and that's the piece of artwork that caught our eye for our Moonlighting, which is our first CD. So when we saw that piece of art, we contacted him and said, Bill, would you mind us using that piece? He said, fine. So the next year when we did Kilimanjaro, I said, we've got to use that Jazz Cat again. So we called Bill up and said, Bill, would you mind doing a different rendition? And every year he's always drawn a new Jazz Cat.
Over the years, Russ and the guys have done more than just please fans. They've gotten involved in music therapy for special needs patients, often children.
Music therapy is something we became aware of about 12 years ago. I started getting fan mail from people, remarkable fan mail, really unusual things like, I was in a coma for 6 months and I awoke to the sound of your music because my family knew that I loved your music and I emerged from a coma from it. And I had got more than one letter from a mother who said that her infant child hated music but could listen to our music. And I couldn't believe we were getting letters like this. So I became aware of this organization called the National Association of Music Therapy. Got in touch with them, found out what they were all about, and we decided to start doing clinics in different hospitals and facilities throughout the country.
Well, they say music soothes the soul. Today we got a chance to find out. Rippingtons Jazz Band performed at Freedom Middle School today for a group of disabled students. The group believes that music can be therapeutic and can help people recover from serious illnesses and trauma.
I think it gives the kids a level playing field. You know, I think the kids are starting to understand they might be a little bit different or disadvantaged, and they're not disadvantaged or different when we're all together playing music. And I think that's important for their self-esteem.
By the way, Rippingtons' album Black Diamond debuted at number one on Billboard's contemporary jazz chart.
None of the Rippingtons, past and present, can quite believe it's been two decades since Russ first put the band together.
They've really given so much to today's music, and anyone that lasts for 20 years has got to be putting out quality.
I'm still trying to figure how did 20 years go by, but yeah, it really is nice to be a part of. I think really the thing of this, this, you know, melody gets the first priority, that's really important for me. So that automatically kind of ties me to Russ Freeman because he's a melody guy.
Well, I just want to know what we're going to do for the 40th anniversary. Someone's going to have to wheel us in. We'll all be in wheelchairs.
I got a song for you, Russ. It's going to go like this.
And he'll go,
oh, that's great. Perfect.
We should be so lucky that in 20 years from now, we're still making music together.
I think the thing I'm most proud of after 20 years with the Rippingtons is the relationships we've made with our fans. I think that's been the most lasting thing and the most rewarding is to have people enjoy the music that I've written and that we've created as a band. And to see some value come from that. So it's been kind of a hard experience to describe, really. All written music is autobiographical to a degree. And I would have to say that my moves throughout the United States have been kind of autobiographical. I've written about my life and my experiences. And the one thing that I think I've had a great opportunity is to see this country. This is the most fantastic thing about touring. And I realized early on that I just love the United States. It's a wonderful place. And so I've tried to take advantage of places that I really love, like the mountains of Colorado and the beaches of Florida, and be able to experience them and to bring kind of my vibe to our music with that.